Hello. For the next 10 minutes or so, we're going to be reviewing Lyme disease. Physicians have recognized relapsing fevers for a long time, actually ever since the time of Hippocrates. Recognition of Lyme disease as a clinical entity is a more recent event. Few other diseases are characterized by this two or more episodes of fever, which is separated by a week-long period of well-being. And as a group, relapsing fevers can be divided into two forms, louse-borne or tick-borne. Louse-borne, caused by Borrelia recurrentis, is a more severe infection. The causative agent of Lyme disease is a spirochete, and the principal agent is Borrelia burgdorferi in North America and also in Europe. Borrelia afzelii and Borrelia garenii are causative agents in most cases in Europe, Russia, and Northern Asia, and they cause a variant of Lyme disease. The spirochete can be visualized by dark field microscopy or phase contrast microscopy. Light microscopy requires special stains in order for you to visualize the bacterium. The agent is a spiral filamentous bacterium. Infection of reservoir and vector hosts is extracellular and not intracellular. In fact, the disease is mediated by endotoxins, which are lipoproteins and not LPS. These lipoproteins are potent B-cell mitogens. The vectors for Borrelia burgdorferi are hard ticks that belong to the Ixodes genus. In North America, these principal vectors are Ixodes scapularis and Ixodes pacificus. Ticks become infected when they feed as larvae or nymphs on infected mammals or birds. And humans are accidental hosts, commonly become infected through the bite of nymphs rather than adult ticks. Nymphs are smaller and hence they go unnoticed compared to adult ticks. And they can feed for several days before dropping off. So this slide shows the life cycle of Borrelia burgdorferi. As mentioned in the previous slide, Ixodes nymphs are the ones that transmit the bacteria to humans, which are accidental hosts. The life cycle involves mainly rodents and large mammals. Next, we review the epidemiology of Lyme disease. Lyme disease can occur in the following areas in North America: in northeastern states, Virginia to Maine, the north central states, and west coast, principally northern California. The risk factors for Lyme disease are essentially those activities that increase exposure to tick bites, such as gardening, hunting, or hiking in an area where Lyme disease is known to occur, having a pet that may carry the ticks home, or if you walk through tall grasses where ticks may live. Lyme disease can be divided into three stages. Firstly, early localized Lyme disease, and then after that, early disseminated Lyme disease, and then finally, late disseminated Lyme disease. Clinical manifestation of early localized Lyme disease begin days or weeks after infection with flu-like symptoms. Other symptoms that are characteristic of this stage of illness is erythema migrans, and then things like stiff neck, muscle pain, and lymphadenopathy. And the symptoms may come and go. Patients have this stage of illness. An early disseminated stage of disease can occur weeks to months after the initial tick bite, and the disease can present as facial palsy, myalgia, pain or swelling in the knees and other large joints, cardiac arrhythmia, and shooting pains that may interfere with sleep. In the late disseminated stage of Lyme disease, this stage of illness can occur months or years after the initial infection. And patients can present with muscle and joint inflammation or Lyme arthritis, muscle weakness, numbness and tingling, speech problems, and memory and sleep disorders. To confirm the diagnosis, laboratory tests are needed, and the principal one used is a serological approach. And this is a two-stage test, firstly to screen with an enzyme immunoassay or immunofluorescence assay. These assays are typically very sensitive and require confirmation and usually in the form of a Western blot. There are several other tests that have been developed and described, but these are mostly unvalidated for clinical use. For treatment of early Lyme disease, patients can be divided into two groups. For patients without neurological manifestation or atrioventricular block, oral antibiotics can be used. for example, or a doxycycline for 100 milligrams twice daily, or amoxicillin 500 milligrams three times daily, or cefuroxime 500 milligrams twice daily for 2 weeks could be given to the patients. Macrolides are not recommended. For patients with neurological manifestations, then IV antibiotics are needed. The recommended one is IV ceftriaxone, 2 grams per day for 14 days. Alternatively, penicillin could be used. For patients with late-stage Lyme disease, then treatment is over a longer period. For Lyme arthritis, oral doxycycline, amoxicillin, or cefuroxime could be used, but over a period of 4 weeks. For patients with late neurologic Lyme disease, then IV ceftriaxone has to be given at 2 grams per day for 2 to 4 weeks. If you need more information on the doses and the choice of antibiotics, then I refer you to this reference given at the bottom of the slide in Clinical Infectious Disease 2006 paper, where this whole issue is discussed in greater detail. Following treatment, 10 to 20% of patients may have persistent or recurrent symptoms. And collectively, these are just termed as post-treatment Lyme disease syndrome, although there's no list of specific symptoms or signs that characterize this group of syndromes. So this has been a quick review of Lyme disease, and I hope that this is beneficial to you, and I wish you all the very best for your exams.